Hello, everyone. It's Brooke Andrew here. I'm really happy to be here with Dale and Megan. But first, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, of the Wurundjeri, the Woiwurrung and Bunurong peoples of the Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to the elders past and present. It's so great to be here. And thanks for joining us. And Megan and Dale, would you like to introduce yourselves?
Shall I go first? Kia ora koutou, mihi atu kia koutou. I would like to first thank Muma and Brooke and Dale for this opportunity to have this conversation. My name is Megan Tamati-Quennell. I'm a curator at Papa and at the Govert Brewster Art Gallery. I have to say what I'm wearing. I'm wearing a black shirt. I'm wearing all black today, apart from I have checked trousers, but you can't see them because I'm sitting down. I'm looking forward to the conversation this evening as well.
And Yama, kia ora, good evening. My name's Dale Harding. I'm currently in Brisbane on the lands of the Turrbal and Jagera communities. And I'd like to acknowledge that I'm here on this country as an unwelcome visitor and acknowledge all the other country around the and communities around the nation. And also to sing out to Megan and your communities and the colleagues over in New Zealand as well, Aotearoa. I'm currently, surprise, surprise, wearing black on black on black. And I'm in my studio and I believe I'm facing fairly eastward. Good evening.
Thanks, Dale. I should have also, and Megan, I should also say I'm wearing, I think it's grey, black, and I've got a few boomerang sculptures by Arnie Lorraine, Connolly Northey hanging up behind me, which I'm
beautiful.
So happy to have. And as we know, we'll be talking about, a whole bunch of really interesting stuff called, as we've coined this talk, determined sensibilities. And those of you who have read the little blurb about what we are talking about today, it's really kind of arguably looking at the way in which that we ourselves kind of label ourselves and the way in which that the kind of language in English, like abstraction, conceptual, minimalism, has really affected us and our communities. And I know that in the 80s, there were certain cultural theorists around the world who even wanted to place people like the famed Emily Kamgawarai as an expressionist, for example. And even the word conceptual, I remember going to art school and people would say, well, are Aboriginal people conceptual? And so these are the kind of things that always have been challenging for many of us, Mob. And I know, Megan, that you've often reflected on people got abstraction. Is there a Māori abstraction? And I think that maybe now people are used to Indigenous people using our own language or words to describe who we are and also using language in our artworks or even writing in our own languages or part thereof when it comes to essays, etc., theatre, many other different creative forms. And so this is really an opportunity to speak with Dale and Megan about their own perspectives on these. And in that, I might actually just quickly share my screen and kick this one off, dive in deep, I think, might as well. So we've got these four terms: abstraction, reduced, minimal, and conceptual. And Dale, I was just wondering if you could pick out the words here that you're closely kind of related to, because I know that we did this in collaboration between Megan and yourself.
Yeah. Well, minimal is the one of the ones that comes to mind often, but not minimal like minimalists or minimalisms like New York or Australian or European minimalisms, but minimal like reduced or, again, abstracted, or the idea of making a minimal gesture, a minimal mark, a minimal intervention, to media, to the actual materials, or a minimal intervention among the subject matter. So minimal is one that comes to mind often. Conceptual is also probably the next one for me. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Megan, what about you?
As a curator, I suppose I do lean towards all of those ideas, minimal, conceptual, abstraction, reduced. I mean, and for me, a lot of them are interchangeable. Abstraction, I've done a project for a long time, which I've called, which is, it's a Māori modernism project that looks at a whole lot of artists who were operating in the 50s and 60s who took on European modernism, and they were artists in a Western sense with a capital A, and they worked and took on European modernism, but they kind of made it their own. Right. So I suppose I like things that are very pared back and pulled back and are abstracted or are minimal or are reduced, are conceptual. And I think all of those things live within the culture anyway. You know, yes. So they're all apparent. I mean, you can't, there's conceptual ideas everywhere, you know, within the culture anyway. There's abstract ideas that we work with. We work with things like, for example, if you talk about like even like death ceremonies, you have what's called a kauimati, which when you can't be, that person can't physically move somewhere else, they take their spirit or that idea. So that's a conceptual idea and it's an abstract idea, and that's inherent within the way in which we operate. So it's not surprising to me that that also sits within the art.
Yeah, agreed. And similarly, I was just wanting to brush up on some of the textbook definitions of abstraction and reducible and these kind of ones. And while they are applicable among sciences and other different fields of work and study as well, they're just normalized, that they're everyday and they're commonplace among not only Indigenous cultures, but just the ways of life. So they can be applied in really specific ways in contemporary art or art historical ways. But also, as Megan says, I totally agree that abstraction is just normal. Even the way slang comes in, the abstraction of language, so that say young people might have access to a word and they abstract a Western word or even abstract one of their own traditional languages so that they have access to that themselves, and maybe it's owned by them and maybe not the adults, this kind of thing.
I mean, you're both international travelers and I'm sure have found yourselves in a few different cafes or restaurants or exhibition openings or seminars where people are speaking about the often Western trajectory of conceptual, for example, or abstraction. I mean, all of these are very much embedded within a Western trajectory of creation, art making, that comes from those places. So has there been any confusion when you've talked about it? Has there been like a kind of a language difference or confusion? And I was just wondering if you could both share a story maybe about that.
Definitely. I remember I was with you, Brooke, and we were at the Tate Modern and we were doing a talk about Indigenous art there and what it actually was. And I did my spiel about Māori modernism, and I talked about, I talked about Michael Parikōwhai, who's very Duchampian in his practice, but of course with a Māori lens, who completely engages with conceptual art. He is a conceptual artist, but he does it through, I mean, that's the pivot. The pivot is that he does it through a Māori lens. And so what he adds to it is something that's unique to here. And so I'm not saying that he doesn't have any relationship with that art or art history, because he's squarely in it, but he's kind of shifting it to kind of work for himself. Anyway, I was asked in there, they asked why I would use such terms, or why I talked about Māori minimalism. Actually, I'd done a project called Māori Minimalism and International Influence, where I put Ralph Hortady's work, Ed Reinhardt's work. I worked with another curator on that project, Chelsea Nichols, who was the modern art curator. So her and I put that show together, and then I added Matt Penny into the mix, who is a completely formalist artist. Anyway, for me, what was interesting was, even Chelsea said at the end of it, you know that thing you said about Māori minimalism? I said, yes. She said, it is actually real. And I was like, well, did you think I was just making it up as I went along? You know, that made me laugh. She said it was actually a thing. And for me, I put Matt Penny in because he's a minimalist sculptor, much more than Hortady was. he's a minimal abstractionist. And so if you can split hairs, but I was like, I'm not sure you can call him a minimalist. He's not quite there. But this guy who kind of cut in the middle really was. And of course, he was really influenced by Ed Reinhardt's black paintings, and he continued to paint. He was a black colour painter throughout his life, blah, blah. Anyway, it was interesting. In both cases, they asked me why I would use such terms. And for me, both of those two that I talked about, like Ralph and Matt, for example, they both went to art school in London in the 60s. So they learnt, but then, as I said, they added a New Zealand or a Māori vernacular to those learnings and shifted it slightly.
Yeah. I could give anecdote, but Megan, I'd love to ask, how do you feel that an Indigenous lens or a way of approaching in the moment, in the time when those movements were occurring, how easily or how readily do you think that happens? How does that occur? I've got my own ideas, but I'd love to hear from maybe a Māori way.
I think at the time I probably was quite difficult because I don't think that they were really taken seriously, you know, so their work, if they were Cubist painters, they were seen as bad Picassos. You know, there's a lot of Indigenous artists, whether you go to Daphne Ojig, who's a Native Canadian painter, and did a whole lot of work. They started calling her the Picasso of Canada. You know, they did that here. They talked about artists who were the Picasso of this or that, you know, and so I think they weren't kind of taken seriously. So I think it was quite difficult to start with to kind of be taken seriously as artists, as contemporary artists in the first instance, not carvers or weavers. You know, we have customary ways of being in terms of art and art practice. But this was a different way through. And for me, I felt like those ones who kind of broke with that tradition in the 50s and 60s, it was a different way of speaking. And they just wanted to be contemporary artists. They didn't want to be contemporary Māori artists. They just wanted to be contemporary artists. But of course, they brought themselves to it. So I don't know if it was, I mean, now it's probably a much easier maybe because people are going through art school training. But I think at that time, it wasn't, what was it to be a modern artist if you're an Indigenous artist in the 50s and 60s? What was that? How did that look? What was that like? You know, I think it probably would have been extremely difficult.
Right. And contemporaneously, yeah, you're right, but successive generations have come through and studied and been familiar with the language. I'd say probably our local region, the general public's more familiar with the language now. All these key terms that we're talking about tonight, just in general daily use, that I mean, even the way that abstraction is now you know, readily applied, maybe out of different contexts. So as a younger person now, I am quite aware to not use ism or the ist to apply a group of people or a movement, because I'm not there in that moment, but certainly there were, you know, Indigenous artists and practitioners working in the moment that these fields were being developed and the language was being solidified. But it's been helpful for me to be really aware not to use the ism or the ist, you know, not to be a minimalist, because I wasn't there in that time. But certainly my natural sensibilities just apply really readily, and so do my families, which is why I'm so keen for this conversation. Yeah.
So just in regards to that, because there, if you look at minimalism or minimalist, but you say that you paint or you create work or sculpture in a minimal way. So in a conversation, how do you construct that? Because there is a difference.
Yes, there is.
Yeah. I have to be really considered in the way that I construct it to not, A, cause people to go, why do you want to be like white people's movements? If I have ism or an ist on the end, that has often received a certain response. And that's a valid response. And so I've had those conversations. But when I don't want to have that conversation, I'll suggest that I'm operating, I seek to work with a minimal gesture, where I'm approaching this with a minimal sensibility, or I'm affecting a minimal sort of, attention to the material or the subject matter. So I try to bring it back to the action of the doing more so than the time frame in art history. Yeah.
Mm. Maybe we should jump right in then to the little, our minimal conceptual reduced
abstraction.
Abstraction. More like design. I had lots of fun putting this together. Here we go. Abstraction.
Right.
Just so everyone out there who's watching this, what we decided to do was both Megan and Dale chose an image each, which references the four different terms that we're looking at today. And maybe, Megan,
yeah, would you want
to kick this one off?
So this one is, this work here is a painting by a woman called Mary Lodge. And it's called Ruatoru Series, 1965. I've not seen it in the flesh, I've only seen it as an image. She's what you'd call one of the women of Māori modernism who people don't know really. And I'm on the brink of doing a show which really looks at the women who were working from about the 1930s through to, it's a quite a distinct period, to about the 1970s. The first, one of the first artists, I would say, women artists who were working, you know, consciously in a contemporary kind of or modern way, consciously, was a woman called Damai Hayward, but I think her real name was, it's gone out of my brain actually, sorry. She had another name. And so Damai Hayward was a photographer, and she had her own photographic studio, but she also did set design for like theatre. And she also became probably one of the first Māori filmmakers. And she worked with her husband Riddle and made movies. So Mehdi comes a bit later. She went to Elam School of Fine Arts. These are people who started going to art school. And actually the first Māori artist to graduate from a fine art school in this country was a woman called Pauline Yeaberry, and she graduated in 1946. And historically, it's always been said that it was a man called Selwyn Wilson who graduated in 1952. And then it was also said, or it was Arnold Wilson who graduated in sculpture and first to graduate in sculpture in 1954. But she was 1946, so she was quite a way before them, but of course not recognised. And so this work here, as I said, Mary Lodge is still around, and she's, she's really interesting. So I'm only starting to unpack her work, and I've yet to have a proper conversation with her. She made these amazing bronzes as well, which could rival someone like Barbara Hepworth. So I chose this work purposely because I wanted to make sure there were female in here, and because I was quite excited about her work in practice.
And what is abstraction about this? Why did you choose that word, or why are you putting it in? Because I think when I've heard you talk about Māori abstraction, of course, it is specific, but it's also in a way quite diverse, really, isn't it?
So this is obviously a landscape. So Ruatoria series, Ruatoria is a place, but it's her home place. And so she's painting her home place in a very kind of abstract kind of way, because of course it doesn't look like this at all. So she's abstracted ideas from that place, and maybe it's a remembered kind of, or it's an intuitive or whatever it is. But for me, it's really, I chose it as an abstract image because she's talking about something specific, but making it much broader, if you understand what I'm trying to say. So this is her home place and her community, but it really doesn't look, as I said, it's not a literal kind of translation of what that place is. Perhaps it's how she felt about it, or it's her response to it. So I loved it as an image because, to me, it's very visceral. And, I thought it was a really interesting image.
Dale Kate's work is it's so beautiful, but it kind of reminds me of being in a plane and looking over the landscape, and I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but it kind of looks like a landscape as well.
Certainly, yeah, and it's called Carnarvon 2020. It's by Kate Harding. Disclosure, that's my mother, Kate Harding, and this is in the Moomer show. But certainly it is landscape. So I've chosen this in celebration because there's been a long trajectory or movement that Kate's been working towards in being able to tell her own story. And that's, I guess, coming back to this determined, could be self-determined, but certainly on her own, in her own terms, and developing her own language, Kate's come along to this abstracted design, which she's referring heavily to Carnarvon. It is about her place and her story, and she's filled that with narrative. She's pointed to certain blocks over time and indicated that it actually is holding content and a range of content. But what Kate's done is she's worked to pigment each of the textiles, collaborating with some friends, Jan Oliver and Mandy Quadrio. But Kate's worked to pigment the textile with actually the places that that she's referring to and holding the content in the colour, but also in terms of the material process as well. She's able to be determined in choosing how she abstracts and represents her image. So, I can't speak for the content in this, but for me, it's one of those milestones in the conversation, particularly in my family, that Kate has been able to embed all of this story in there that she could point to with different people. But she's gone beyond the disclosure or the figurative disclosure to an outside audience. She can choose and be determined in how she invites people into that, if at all. Mm. So, and there's also little tiny pitchery bags or little tiny dilly bags that she's woven using size 100 crochet thread, tiny little microscopic thread. So that's another abstraction as well. She's potentially seeing them as metonymic, being standing for figures, you know? Yeah. Mm.
Could you just explain Carnarvon for people who don't know the context?
Sure. So Carnarvon is an abbreviated way of describing in what is Western Queensland, now called Carnarvon Gorge. And that is a significant ecological site as an outset, but it's an incredibly important cultural and spiritual homeland for many peoples. But actually both of my grandparents, Kate's parents, were maintained in their responsibilities and their unbroken connection to Carnarvon Gorge and the surrounding ranges through their entire lives, which is how Kate is so identified and connected to that place. But also we're quite aware and on the record always that there's a range and a vast number of people who actually trace their spiritual homeland back to Carnarvon at the gorge itself. Yeah.
It's very interesting how, unbeknownst to each other, I think, that you chose both works are landscapes and are special places of country, but under the title of abstraction. And I was wondering if you had any thoughts on that.
I think it's that thing too, from a cultural perspective, like what is made available and what isn't, you know, and maybe they're like mnemonic devices as much as anything, that it's a touchstone for something much deeper. So right. As I said, I can't unlock all of what Mehdi's doing here because, as I said, that's not my place, that's her place, and I've not yet had that conversation. But her work, which focuses on Ruatoria, a place that she's connected to tribally, you know, there'll be a depth of meaning in this work that I don't necessarily hold. She holds that. Right. So I think it's that thing of like abstraction. Maybe it's that idea that you give a sense of something, but not the whole thing. And like Dale was saying, maybe at that point it's more determined about, you can determine what it is that you're giving and what it is that you're holding back.
Certainly, Megan. Yeah, totally. And earlier on, I wrote down codified languages or codified figures, this kind of thing, in that perhaps this could be a bigger, longer conversation, that asking the questions of what has been other original or subsequent forms of abstraction, what was the intention for that? Certainly, I would suggest that Kate has sought out ways to abstract her knowledge so she can codify it and keep that safe to herself. And yeah. We all are quite aware that this is not a new practice, right? It's not something that's been developed in 2020, but certainly it's a new form and a new media for my immediate family and community, that Kate might be moving into this space and demonstrating that this is possible. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So. Let's jump from abstraction to reduced. I'm so fascinated by reduced. And the way in which these images sit really well together.
It's so beautiful. It's
really great. Dale, Could you maybe give your what is reduced again?
Right. Well, in my making, reduced is a way that I try to simplify things, really. Often, and I have learned this, Vernon Arkey has been the one to describe this in specific language, and that reducing it down to what's necessary.
Mm.
I heard Vernon as a student when I was studying as an undergraduate student. And it's also something that's natural in my way of being. So that's why I caught it. But reducing it down, that if you don't need all of the trimmings and the extra layers of codification, signifying, decoration, all these kind of things, surface, reducing it down. And that's when I really get stirred by these images here. Brooke, would it make sense if I jump to speaking about the taonga, the nala nala?
Absolutely, absolutely.
So I'm identifying you, because they're currently on show at the Govert Brewster in Taranaki in New Zealand, Aotearoa. I'm using the word taonga because they're there and that's appropriate and how we've been referring to them. They're also nala nala or throwing sticks here in this context here in Queensland. And they're made from native hardwoods. A quick background is that they're currently on loan from the Te Papa National Museum among a range of taonga or ancestral objects from Queensland. These 18 nala nalas were able to be loaned for the show so that I could celebrate them, bring them into the conversation, and so that we could document them, but also so we could identify the fact that, my goodness, I can't even really put it into language, but there is so much knowledge and information included in that very reduced and slender form that I kind of stumble around trying to describe why I'm so motivated by them. But what it probably comes back to is that as a sculptor and as a younger person making these kinds of forms, they're not easy to make. So they visually quite simple. There's not a great deal of surface information. But in order to carve and to form that hardwood, to take those very slendered and multi-tapered, they taper in and out and back in again. That's not easy to do. To have it solid and to have it uniform, that's very complex making. And the amount of information and knowledge, material knowledge, process knowledge, but then also conceptual, personal intent, the amount of knowledge and information that is distilled and reduced into those forms is off the charts. And so just read this one, if I may. Without personal lived experience in all the applications or intentions for these taonga or nala nala, I can only partially infer some of the choices that were made in their manufacture. So as a young person, I can only partially infer some of the choices that were made. And what I can point towards is the skillful choices made in their manufacture that are still evident in the form, in the reduced form, that's actually very difficult to make, particularly if you look at the silhouette. In the ergonomics, they're ergonomically and even scientifically considered. They're very, very, what do we call that? Yeah, they're ergonomically formed in their scale, in their dimensions, and in their weight, but also in things like the surface treatment, in the striations. They're reduced in the fact that there could be decoration or there could be layers figures and story put onto them. But the vast majority of them only really have striations in the gesture of the mark that's finished them off. So the striation is the reduced, again, reduced down to just simply the a very sensitive and careful surface finish. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're very powerful bundis, as we call them. And I think that obviously this is the mark of high design and accuracy over thousands and thousands of years of honing and honing and honing into like the perfect object, like the aerofoil, which is the boomerang, the only aerofoil in the world. And I know that Māori culture is, exquisitely beautiful like this, but also honed as well. Megan, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Absolutely. And I tell a story about there's a work called Unuku, which is, it kind of looks like this, it's a carving. And my cousin used to talk about it as like something like pure idea, because really it's based on this idea of a rainbow, but it actually looks like this. And so it's like this pure idea, this work, and it's really pulled back. And interestingly too, there's a lot of very ornate carvings, but where I come from in the south, for example, the work down there is much like this is very reduced and really pulled back and very little surface decoration. It's really just about the form, completely about the form, and probably its function and its form kind of interlinked, not just its form, but also how it operated. But the surface decoration is completely gone. So for me, it was really interesting, it was, you know, was never there. And I think it was to do with how, one, we operated, we didn't, there was less kind of wood in the South Island, less carving, whereas you have others like very beautifully ornate te arawa, you know, beautiful from the from other areas, which are really amazing. Ours were like this kind of weird, almost Quaker looking thing. So I these forms to me are, you know, when you talked about the essential kind of form, that just, you know, nothing there that didn't need to be there. And we have similar things. As I said, it depends on where you come from, because for kaido across or carving across the country is different in different areas. But yeah, so I mean, they're absolutely stunning, these nula nula, and to be able to have them in the show that Dale selected them for the show was really amazing.
I mean, of course, it evokes the vast kind of colonial loot and disruption to cultures internationally, and I'm very curious about what other provenance information there is, but that would take us to another
place. Well, they haven't been, the way we talked about them in the show too, was we kind of tried to liberate them from the museum in many ways and put them in a contemporary art context, not because they're contemporary art, but really to talk about other things and their relationship to Dale and his family. And they haven't been in an Indigenous Australian context since they were probably put in. I mean, they've been in the museum since 1968, some of them. So for a very long time, 1868, sorry, not 1968, 1868. So for a very long time, they've been away from family. So, you know, they've been away from family. So to have them here is kind of extraordinary, and to be able to have them in a context that Dale and his family were comfortable with was really good.
Thanks, Megan. And yeah, I'm very proud of them. I'm proud of the skill and the knowledges and the people who've made these into the world. And one of the things about these Nulla Nulla being in collections around the world, and Bruce McLean has also curated some into his show at iObject, at his last show at Gallery of Modern Art in Brisbane. Very similar, from even from the same location, same material processes. With them, with the histories and the experience in Central Queensland, what I really love being able to do with the show is that re-familiarising families and communities that this is actually yours. And these forms, I personally haven't seen these forms being made around me, very similar and in their lineage and sort of maybe descended forms, but coming and recalling these very precise and outstanding forms is what I'm really excited by.
It's such a proud moment, isn't it, when really things do get turned and things become incredibly visible. Megan, I know you have talked about Ralph's work quite extensively with me in the past, and it's such a beautiful set of two images here together.
So those two black paintings are a pair. Ralph Horsley is probably one of our most important New Zealand artists. And he was the first Māori artist to really be regarded in the art mainstream. He was picked up in 1961 and acknowledged as a painter. And he worked, as I said, he left New Zealand, went to the Central School of Art in London, and was said to be very influenced by people like Ed Reinhardt, Malevich, all of those kinds of people, worked through that and then came home again. He was only away for like 3 or 4 years. And I chose this for reduced because, of course, it's a reduced colour palette. And you can't see it very much, but in here there's text which says melody, 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 and there's text that way. But it's like he works with colour in terms of the black. Some is matte, some is glossy, you know what I mean? So he's kind of playing with texture in a way, and that you have to read the painting with your eyes as much as you. It also looks like there's a tukutuku panel called Rui Mata Tōrua, which is about the spill of tears. So it has all these kind of references to other things. This one's actually a cross, and it says the same melody, melody, and it's based on a word play or a word poem by a man called Bill Manhire. He was famous for saying, you know, there's nothing better I can say about my art than nothing at all. So he didn't want to speak about his work. He felt like, I suppose, again, it's very Duchampian, that he said everyone wants a kind of an answer to what a work is. And he said, really, people bring themselves to it. And really, it's like that Duchampian thing where the person who's viewing it completes the work. And so he didn't want to give an answer. And so he didn't speak about his work. He was completely silent. But what he did do often was he worked with language. And he also worked with poets often and said, the only people who can really write about my work are poets, because they're the only people who really understood it. Right. As I said, I chose it reduced because he did pull everything back. The other thing that's really extraordinary about Ralph's work, and I kind of quote Rangi Pānoho, who's a very senior Māori art historian, who really talked about how the iwi narrative that this man comes from. He comes from a place up north, and he's what's called Te Aupōuri, which is a tribe in the far north. And they were called Ngāti Ruanui, and then they were attacked by another tribe, so they burnt everything that was of value and escaped under smoke and fire and renamed themselves Te Aupōuri, which really means smoke and fire. So his kind of conversation wasn't saying it's not just Guia or Ed Reinhardt Black, or, you know, it's also Te Aupōuri Māori Catholic Black that Ralph's working with. Because the other thing with Ralph is his family, the area that he came from in Miti Miti, when the Bishop Pompalia arrived in New Zealand, he arrived to his family's area, and they all became like Māori Catholic, Māori French Catholic. So the work has all of those kinds of resonances. So all of that is in there, but again, like Dale was talking about before, it's completely pulled back. Mm. I really did love that it's not just, again, just the Ed Reinhardt kind of reference, that there's like an iwi reference in there, an iwi narrative that sits in behind it. It's oblique, but it's there.
It seems to me that both of these selection of images have a deep connection to deep history. You know, going vastness of it's like and just kind of the tip of the iceberg that we're talking about here. Maybe we should jump on to the next. Minimal. This is an exciting set of images here. I'm loving this conversation. I should also mention to people out there who are listening to us talk, there is the Q&A button there. So please, if you do have any questions, pop them into the question bar and we'll work our way through them. It's probably the easiest thing to do instead of crowding us a bit later. You'll have an opportunity to hopefully get your question answered. So both of these examples are pointy. I'm just kind of loving the fact that you're both, again, selecting these images that really resonate with each other. And Megan, I'm just wondering if you could continue and to talk about Ana Iti's work.
So Ana Iti is a younger Māori artist who, again, she's a really great young artist. And she made this work, which was they're hand-cut fired ceramic tiles on this kind of cedar frame, so it kind of goes up. And the work was, and she kind of was referencing a work by Shonara Peter Davies, who's a senior Māori artist and lives in Wellington, and made a park here called, it's now called Te Aro Park, but at one stage it was called Pigeon Park. Mm-hmm. And it was called Pigeon Park because there were lots of pigeons in it. Anyway, and it had colonial scenes in it. Anyway, she was commissioned to, she won the commission to do this public art work, and I think she was the first Māori woman to be, you know, supported to make a very large sculpture in a really large park. And she made a series of tiles, but what she really did with this park, again, it goes back to quite deep histories, was she reclaimed this. It was an old par site in the middle of Wellington. So an old par site that she kind of pulled back, and what she was able to do with the work that she did was to reclaim that site as Te Aro Pa in Te Aro Park. But I think the real name was Waimapihi, which was her, it was actually called Waimapihi after an ancestor who Shona talks about, a female ancestor who lived there. And she said she was so tapu when she put her feet in the stream, her tapu or her sacredness went all the way down to the sea. So she talks about those kinds of things. There's all these females. Anyway, Anaiti was really, taken with Shona's, and she made a work in response. And she made this extraordinary kind of platform that went up, and it was the only thing that was in the space. And it was such a brave kind of work to do as quite a young artist that she just, again, pulled it all the way back. And then, yeah, so for me, she pulled it so far back, and it was really, in its simplicity, it was really amazing. But as I said, also was having this other conversation with a more senior artist that she was playing homage to.
I'm just wondering, Megan, some people might be thinking, oh, well, you know, this is the label of minimal, playing devil's advocate here, but it's also reduced and also abstract. So I'm just kind of...
And it's conceptual.
But I mean, of course, we are getting down to the nitty gritty of how Indigenous people, you know, are coining these terms and using these terms and referencing these terms and owning these terms and being these terms. And we've done it for many, many other things. But I mean, the word minimal for you.
Minimal, I suppose, is, as I said, I feel it is interchangeable with those other words. Minimal and reduced to me are almost, are very similar, because it's like, it's about intention, maybe, you know, that it's, I mean, she's saying a whole lot of things in a very, minimal way. So she's like taking it back to its essence. She's really speaking through that work to another work, and as I said, paying homage, because Shona's work was made up a series of, you know, hand cut tiles. I don't know how many millions of them, hundreds of them, you know. So she's really speaking to that work in many ways. It's a conversation between works. But minimal to me is really just, I suppose, that essential kind of form, or I don't know if I'm saying it properly.
No, absolutely. And I think that for me, there is an absolute difference between abstract and reduced. And Dale, these are like weapons as well, though, aren't they? They're
amazing.
They could be. This was an early student work. So they're penetrative. Certainly could be weapons, they could be used that way, but definitely they're penetrative because they're surveyor's pegs originally. Mm. The surveyor's pegs, you know, they're the markers of territories and boundaries. So I've spoken about the work in the past that with my family in agriculture, my father would say, if you see a surveyor's peg in the paddock, you leave it alone. And he was suggesting that for certain reasons, because it made it easy for everyone's kind of job. But also this idea that a timber wooden peg in the landscape as the marker of ownership and boundaries. And if a bushfire comes through, it means nothing really at all. And so that's where the work breaking boundaries comes from. So there's surveyor's peg, the surveyor's tape, and they've been impacted by fire at different rates. But certainly for me, the word minimal here has reference to the cereal, but also perhaps maybe the, the mass-produced unit. That unit that's readily available and the multiple in that. I've made a number of works around multiples, but the idea of taking a mass-produced unit and drawing that into the practice, that fits with me in some of the conversations around other minimalisms, but also the very simplistic material treatment. I am a little self-conscious in that I've included two works by myself and one of my mother's. And
good.
But it's good because what I would like to do is to not speak for other artists' work, but what we can, many of us do, is probably look to see these works and see how someone else has treated it very similarly. You know, say the way that rum bottles were painted on and taken into the practice in places like Cherbourg. So the idea of the readily available manufactured unit comes to mind that way. But these works may be echoed in other practices that certainly are around.
Dale, I mean, you talked about the serial and you're talking about the kind of manufacturing. In that way, would you think that it's also connected to something like that other term, the ready-made?
Yeah, sure. That's there. The one on the far right is essentially a ready-made that could be just taken out of the paddock somewhere. Certainly the ready-made's definitely part of that. And what I have enjoyed is being able to learn these different languages and other artists' practices and why and how they might be relevant to what we're doing now. But also, as we've all been saying, is shift them, but also maybe to give that language to family and community members who are artists but aren't trained in the same kinds of languages and formats that we've been trained in. Yeah. So minimal is something that might be easily received, particularly if we can bring it back to the fact that you can have that ready-made. You can go to the hardware store and purchase these objects that you know in the world and trade upon all of their material signifiers and all of their subject matter and bring that into the work.
Mm-hmm. Maybe let's jump to conceptual, one of my favorite words, because I mean, conceptual is such an interesting context. Well, even from my own practice, even just being out there in the world, I even find that North American, European views of what conceptual is varies quite a bit anyway, and not just about the 70s, for example, or the 60s. I mean, it's one of these kind of words that kind of gets around, I suppose. And I'm just wondering if both of you have had that experience with conceptual.
Oh, I could jump in. Yeah, certainly there's degrees of conceptual practice by artists like Art and Language and these kind of ways of making art and putting ideas forward that is heavily, you know, it's language-based. There's material process at times, but it's language-based. But for me, the conceptual comes in the way that, say, for example, a family member might see a thing, and the thing might be timber, but that it actually is the object. It is the figure that it's being represented by, that it's representative of, that it actually doesn't stand in for it, but actually holds all of that concept, all of that story, all of that knowledge. So it becomes the thing. So I guess over the years, I've even looked at the way that Aboriginal Australian artists have shifted the way that appropriation, the textbook definitions of appropriation via postmodernism, they've been shifted and taken into multiple different ways of applying appropriation by Australian Aboriginal artists. I've been looking at that over the years, and I'd say conceptual can be brought back into home and community practice through those understandings that in this work, the xantharia resin, the grass tree botanical resin, that just that material holds all these different conversations that many different people can have at different degrees of contact with that. And then we can talk about, you know, the register of the body and the length of the piece of glass. It's actually my height, this kind of stuff. So, but for me, the idea of bringing that conceptual possibility back into a material form as well is really interesting. That already present, it's already happening, it's already doing. Why did you use that piece of timber? Why that tree? Why did you choose that tree for that thing? And often there is a big, long, multiple conversation story behind that. So bringing the conceptual back into the material process as well as the language and the ideas is also something I'm quite interested in.
I mean, often in the conceptual too, as you've just kind of touched on, it's quite a loaded set of maybe instructions or pathways to get to something which looks quite reduced, minimal. But it's really that process. And you just mentioned your height.
Right. Yes. well, that's a register. That's a register of the body. And again, you know, yeah, perhaps we can go there, because within a First Nations context, the idea of the body being registered in the museum, a measurement of the body in the museum, that then itself becomes whole many, many different conversations. I hope that that's where we can go, because that's what I'm intending by doing. We can see the register of the body and the ergonomics in other forms, like the taonga, the nalanoa, the wadis.
Okay.
We can see that register of the body there. We can see the register of body in other pigment-based art forms. But what happens when we start to talk about the register of our own bodies, Jimmy Durham and all the other artists who have inserted their bodies into the historical museological context? But just in simply in a material or in that measurement, the idea that it is my body, then all the other dialogue comes. And perhaps it's not written about. Say the other conceptual artists who have, you know, have shaped this discourse, it's often been published and written, so it can be shared and maybe demonstrated or tested and debated in discourse. But here, it's probably not written in on paper or published in language. It's actually the conceptual content is imbued into the material and the process, the treatment.
Mm. I mean, Megan, when it comes to Matt Pine's work, though, it's in some ways the information is revealed to a point.
Yes, well, it is. Well, it is, because we've written it here. But, yeah, it's a conceptual work in that, again, I mean, it can be a minimal work too, because it is minimal. It's a minimal sculpture. And the thing that Dale was talking about before, so there is relationship through, I think, to other words. You know, you were talking about the survey pegs and the seriality, and then you were talking about the ready-made and stuff. I mean, he sources materials that are everyday materials. Very, you know, he went to the Central School of Art and was really taken with people like Carl Andre and his use of bricks, or, you know, so he's here, what he's doing is he's mapping past sites using everyday materials. And I really love them, because what he talks about is this pre-European form of Māori architecture, which we used all the time, which was about land modification, and they were our past sites. You know, and they're quite heavy subjects, because some of those past sites were to do with fighting and was to do with colonization and all of those kinds of things, but he uses PVC pipe to kind of map it all. Right. And this one here, in terms of the conceptual stuff, a past site doesn't, you know, this is he's it's almost like a schematic drawing of a past site, but of course he's kind of abstracted it at the same time. And then this one here, the one that's above it, the trench design, but he was really talking about the actions. So he was talking, and it goes to what you were also talking about, Dale. This is about a bodily mapping of space.
Right.
So he's talking about the movement on that past site. It doesn't actually look, that past site doesn't look like a step ladder. So there's a step ladder, there's a walkway, and there's a crawling form. So he was a passage form that you would crawl through. So he was talking about mapping that space bodily, and right, what that movement might have been on that par site, which is why he's called it Impressions of Gate Par. Gate Par is a famous par where we almost defeated the British, and it's where this trench design that Māori came up with, there's a particular person, I don't know his name, unfortunately, I should have done my research before, is known, a Māori man is known for making this particular type of trench warfare, which then they used later. But what he was doing there is he pulls it away from all that and talks about the movement. So for me, it is, I mean, his work is really, he's quite something else to me.
Right. I can see you've really moved, Megan, and I you used the word schematic.
Yeah.
And I say in the similar ways that other conceptual artists have published and written, maybe as books, at a set of instructions or a way of approaching a thing, an art thing, or even, you know, whatever, arguing that there's not a thing. That schematic, would you suggest that that the communities that the work belongs to, Matt Pine's communities, do you think they can, would you perceive that they can read that schematic, that there's, that language is transferable or readable or accessible to a home community?
I think that's what we're, I mean, I think it hasn't been. because I think again he's an artist who's been really misunderstood by his own, but I think if there's a, I mean, I think once you start talking and you talk about like Rangiriri Pa or I think this is the wrong name, Te Porere is another pa, but I think that's the wrong name. I think it's Rangiriri, but anyway. I think when you start talking about pa sites, there was a young woman who came in, who Te Ingoa, who might do, like, she's working with me on a project. This work is being made, the Impressions of Gate Pa, and the other one exists from 1979. So he made these in 1979, initially. But the top one's being remade. And when I talked to her about these works and what they, I mean, she cried. And this is a young woman who really, you know, didn't necessarily, hadn't really engaged with his work before. So she understood it once it was kind of opened to her. So I think those schematic drawings, the drawings that he's made, you know, and he's written these things like based on a trench design specifically related, that's him. You know, he was trying to get people to kind of understand where he was. Of course, when you offer them a step ladder, a bridge, and a wooden frame to walk through, you know, my family was like, what is that? you know what I'm saying? So again, I feel like those artists are really kind of brave that they make works that people weren't necessarily at that point in time engaged with, and we're really only catching up now.
I mean, I think that the word brave is really important context here, and I'm just kind of reflecting on a few things that both of you have said, like, when you were saying, Megan, that, you know, people go, oh, that's Picasso style, etc. I mean, knowing very well that it was actually Picasso that was styling us and our brothers and sisters and everyone in between and around. And also, Dale, when you were talking about the I think it was the minimal gesture you were talking about, the painting on the bottles.
Right, right.
Was it Schermansberg? Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Up at Cherbourg.
Cherbourg, sorry. Yeah. You know, and I kind of think about my grandmother saying, Brooke, you're going to do another painting. And I think that these, a lot of our culture and our practice is often caught between like a Western kind of understanding of what expression is. And of course, the multiplicities of extraordinary multiplicities of Indigenous and understanding and ways of expressing life. And Darwin, you were talking about Black Boy 2017, how that really references your body and references kind of, you know, I think you were talking about museums and the collection of maybe human remains.
Right, right. And the possession, the display of bodies. I'm quite often tease out, or even maybe do it. I certainly do at times the thing that is in the scope of critique. Mm. So putting my body on display again is not a new device. I've studied and learned other artists like Jimmy Durham and others who have put their body into that space and made themselves within the gaze. But certainly, the conversations with family members around what does it mean to include yourself these ways, or what does it mean for ancestral objects, taonga, and ancestral presences to be displayed and to put up on a wall and to be put out into public light. Yeah.
I mean, and again, both of you have put up images of, you know, artworks that is really deeply related to the body as well, which is it's really interesting when you talk about this Black Boy 2017 referencing your body. I mean, I just think of the Duckworth Museum in Cambridge that still refuses to return back Aboriginal human remains, yet conceptually and historically it's in the historical record. People know that they're there, it's in the consciousness, except there's no reference to it, there's no kind of admission to it as well. I was just wondering, we actually do have a few little conversations here and little questions, I suppose, or comments. And do you feel like going down that pathway?
Sure.
Yeah.
So one person, it was more of a comment, but I think it's an interesting comment, and I don't know, maybe you might have something to say about it. It's from Anonymous, but it says, comment rather than a question, but it's so interesting, the two images you shared under the title of Minimal. Both are related to demarcated colonized spaces, surveys, pegs, and a city square.
Right.
Right. Yeah.
Another one for Megan.
Okay.
When and where is Meadows' show planned for? Such exciting work. That's also from an anonymous person.
Wow, an anonymous person. Many lodges, I'm wanting to work on a show about the women of Māori modernism, so it won't be just Midi, but hopefully a few women. There was another woman called Georgina Kirby, who's recently just passed away, who was a painter and painted nudes. There was Midi's work. There's Elizabeth Ellis. There is another woman, as I said, Pauline Yeabury, and another woman called Frieda Rankin. So I'm trying to, Marilyn Webb, who was as a printmaker and is still surviving. So some of them are still around. And so I'm hoping to do the research and to find, I have to find the works, because of course they're not in the collection. They've never been collected. We actually bought a Pauline Yeabury from auction very recently that I'm very excited that we have. It's the first kind of work from that period we have from a woman artist, Māori woman artist. So I'm hoping to work on that and to be the show next year at Te Papa. And I think it'll be a small show, but researched and quite pithy, if you know what I mean. We're quite full, and we're thinking about maybe touring it as well, because it's an opportunity to get that. It'll be a great show. It's starting to write an art history that doesn't actually exist. And right. For me, I suppose part of this conversation, even this evening, is I am actively, I believe, or I'm trying to write, you know, I'm actively working to, you know, create this, continue with these other people, not just me doing it, but to write a Māori art history that sits inside and outside of the art mainstream. And it's actually larger than it. And as I said, sometimes it fits in there and sometimes it's uncomfortable in there because it's too restricted in that space. It's broader than actively writing the art history. So that will happen, hopefully, I don't know, maybe the date at the moment is August 2022. And that's what we're working towards.
This is a question from Huel Sims. Maybe it's a cyclic question, but I think maybe people are trying to get their heads around maybe the kind of similarities and terminologies, which of course we've just touched on. And Hill says, could you talk about why which category a work is placed in is important? Perhaps another way to ask this is, to whom is the placing important, the artist or other artists? Which I think, Dale, you've kind of touched on anyway about, like, who, you know, why are you doing it?
Right, yeah. But also, that, as we've all pointed to, they're all interchangeable. And I guess it's like, you know, so many languages, the word for this thing could actually mean many other different things depending on, you know, the way it's applied. So it's easy to remind ourselves that all of these different terms might just apply because we've chosen to put the works into there, but they do switch and interchange and come and go. But yeah.
I felt like the same, that I could have shifted works around, and at one stage Brooke did, and I loved that he put that minimal work of yours, which is about your body, the Black Boy work, alongside the minimal work of Ana Itti's. I felt like that kind of, was it beside Ana Itti's? Yeah, it was. At one stage, anyway, it swapped around, but I felt like those things are interchangeable. I think categories can be annoying and unnecessary, right, at times, and I think artists often, from my experience, not that I'm an artist, I'm a curator, they often resist being defined in a particular way, and sometimes, you know, don't want to be discussed in those ways at all. So I suppose for me, making those definitions, and as I said, because they're interchangeable, I suppose the reason I think they're important is because I suppose I'm trying to demonstrate that those ideas are ideas that we work within as well. So I suppose that's why they're important to me. Right. I don't think they need to be written in stone and people need to be stuck in boxes or things decoded and said it's this, it's not that. Categories also kind of limit us, I suppose. But I think it's like the subject of this talk is determined sensibilities. So it's really about a way of trying to approach work and saying, you know, this work needs to be taken seriously also as art, you know. So do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Megan, I second you there, because part of my sort of little project, one of my projects is that I've touched on it again, is that if grassroots community can recognize that some of this language is not only for books or for contexts other than what they're living, other than what they've already been doing, other than what they inherit and are maintaining.
Yes.
It's not about seeing that we can have one fit inside the other so then it's validated. It's not about plugging one in so that we can draw visibility, these kinds of things. I'm really keen to see that this language is just normalized and claim it, bend it, shift it, use it in your own way, but also recognize that it's already what you're doing. It's already what has been done, and that it doesn't have to be anything other than just what you need it to be. The language is not changeable. It's, for me, I love reading and knowing multiple art histories, and particularly the international applications of some of these practices and how they've sat, but then also get a great thrill when they're applied in a grassroots way.
Yeah. I mean, I think this is the greatest challenge, but also interest that non-Indigenous, you know, art canon or trajectory or, you know, world has with, you know, us as Indigenous people and artists, curators, thinkers, communities, because that we can take a word, we can own it, we can bend it, we can change it, as you say, and then change our minds. And then shift it to something
else.
And I think that's incredibly challenging for some of that mob, and also sometimes for us. But I think that that's just the uniqueness, and we've got so much to play with. There is a question which is, I think, really interesting, Dale, for you. It's saying that the register of the body is very present within your work, and especially at MoMA. It's strikingly powerful, even more so as it feels like it exists across gender in a non-binary way. It touches all. Is that purposeful? That's from an anonymous attendee.
The simple answer is yes. I mean, that's just my ongoing lived experience. Yes. And we can add all sorts of theory, but one of the things that I developed in conversation with a curator named Hendrik Volkerts, I came to the recognition that in art college we did study the body, and then to recognize what is the body, and that when we were presenting the works that we were showing, particularly the registers of my hands, that it wasn't a theoretical body, that it actually was a specific body. And that the body is a certain thing, can be a certain thing, but specifically my body, and specifically the details of a location or a source of a material is really key as well, in the same kind of same register. So, but then it's, so that locks it down or narrows it in to be really purposeful and specific. But of course, it's universal. It moves across, as the questioner asked, and it is beyond binary. So
and maybe this is a funny question to end on. I've kind of had a bit of a giggle when I saw it. It's from an anonymous person as well. How will it feel when your work is canonized and written about within the isms? May not make any relevance now after this last comment.
See, that's a goodie. Let me just sit into that. Like, I don't court it. How does it make me feel? Often it's helpful. Often it's helpful. The honest answer is often it's helpful. Mm. Why? Visibility. Lots of people have made work about Indigenous invisibility and lack of representation, these kind of things. So mm. often it's helpful if one of the isms is plugged into the work or it's written about in that way. It's okay, but also I would look at the context that it's applied, but also particularly the writer and how what their intention is.
Mm.
But how does it make me feel? At times I consider that it's helpful because the canons now, if Indigenous students are learning these canons by prerequisite of the degree, well, then it's plugging back into Indigenous practices and ways of beings and terminologies. It's helpful, yeah. Mm.
I mean, Megan, you really kicked this kind of talk off talking about your experience at the Tate and the abstract, and isms flow straight into that because it also acknowledges and makes visible those Māori artists, and you mentioned other Indigenous artists who were working within those sites of London, arguably Paris, blah, 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 like any other artist who wants to just make work.
Right.
Absolutely. Well, the thing is that they wanted to be artists, and so where were they going to go? You know what I mean? They received information via books. That was at magazines. They'd look at grainy photographs, never actually saw the real this or that. So to be in London and to be able to access things and see things and learn things and, of course, work their way through it. And it's interesting, someone like Horty, for example, went away, you know, as an expressionist painter and came back as a minimal abstractionist. So he kind of worked through everything and got to a certain point and his work completely shifted and was so sophisticated. That's another show that I want to do, which is really looking at those early Māori internationals, those ones who went offshore. There was a man called Selwyn Wilson who was a painter and then he became a ceramic artist and he went to the Central School of Art in London. It's interesting they all end up there. Quarterly went off, got another scholarship, and he went off to the Central School of Art in London. Matt Penny went there and did a graphic design course, but then he decided after that 1 year of doing graphic design, he wanted to be a sculptor, so he went to the Hornsey College of Art, and he was the person who took himself there. So he was there for 10 years working through art and came back and then, you know, reintegrated himself here. And they really were different than the other artists who hadn't had that opportunity or that experience. Their work was in a different, and for a long time wasn't really understood, I don't think. Mm. And so, yeah, I don't know. I find all that stuff fascinating. And I always loved Jimmy Durham's, you talked about Jimmy Durham before, his comment about how Europe was an Indian project because they had studied us for so long. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we're everywhere there. We're not just, you know, we don't just make work here. You know, we're everywhere. And they have been studying us culturally for such a long time. That we're so implicated in those histories, both in England and Europe. You know, we have taonga, we have art, we have all sorts of stuff that is there. And we've been in their consciousness. You talked about Picasso and all of those people who started looking at Indigenous art as an inspiration for their work. So there's a whole history of stuff. And that engagement for me is really important because I feel like those ones who went offshore and went to those schools had agency over that. They decided. They wanted to go there. They came back and wore berets and wanted to be artists with a capital A. They put themselves in the galleries. You know, they wanted to be regarded and seen, and it was really just, I suppose, the racism at home that they weren't kind of valued in the same way. But their work was, they just wanted their work to be as good as everybody else's. And it was, and it is.
Yeah. I recall scenario, Megan, when you say that those senior artists took themselves into that context, I recall being asked, I mean, again, it comes back to being a student, but it's we're talking about being locked into a certain discourse. But I remember being asked, do I want an Indigenous supervisor to assess my work? And that was very early on in the experience of that particular college here at Queensland College of Art. But did I want an Indigenous supervisor to assess the work? And I have an interest in seeing that the work is tested in as many arenas as possible, really. It's all spec. Let's test it, right? In terms of the question and asking around whether, how does it feel being the work being applied or written into an ism, I enjoy the work being tested in as many different contexts and fields as possible. And it's credit to those artists who have sought out those other situations to put themselves into as well.
I mean, coming back to determine sensibilities, and this is what it's about, and it's really important to reflect that we have our own agencies in that. And I'd like to thank you both, Mandangu, for hanging out tonight. This is so exciting, and I hope that everyone here joining us today is safe and well in these times.